Welcome. I'm the Reverend Nan Adams, pastor of Providence Presbyterian Church here in Montgomery, Alabama. We're so glad that you have decided to be with us this night for this incredible worship service, a time of great reflection, solemnity. I will make one announcement. We will not have a benediction yet again tonight. We will not have one until Easter Sunday. And so after Beth is through singing her last song, her last anthem, we will simply depart in silence. Let us worship God. On this Good Friday, we contemplate the good news of the cross, how Christ our Lord stretched out his arms to embrace a world of suffering and sin, how Christ our Lord stretched out his arms to save us. Come and see the beloved Son of God. Come and see the ruler of the nations. Come and see the Savior of the world. He is high and lifted up upon a cross. Let us pray. Lord God, on this haunting holy day, we come to the place of the skull, the place of the cross, the place of our salvation. In the face of such suffering, show us the face of our Savior and the shadow of such evil. Show us the light of your grace. Through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen.
Alas, my dear, I see you bleed, and the king, my sovereign, die. of grief can bury they the pain of love I owe. Lord, I give myself away. 'Tis all that I can do.
You may be seated. Hear the prayer of illumination. Holy God, as we bow our heads beneath the cross, pour out your Holy Spirit upon us to testify to the truth so that we may believe. This we pray through Jesus Christ, your word made flesh. Amen. After Jesus had spoken these words, he went out with his disciples across the Kidron Valley to a place where there was a garden, which he and his disciples entered. Now Judas, who betrayed him, also knew the place, because Jesus often met there with his disciples. So Judas brought a detachment of soldiers together with the police from the chief priests and the Pharisees, and they came there with lanterns and torches and weapons. Then Jesus, knowing all that was to happen to him, came forward and asked them, "For whom are you looking?" They answered, "Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus replied, "I am he." Judas, who betrayed him, was standing with them. When Jesus said to them, "I am he," they stepped back and fell to the ground. Again he asked them, "For whom are you looking?" And they said, "Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus answered, "I told you that I am he. So if you are looking for me, let these others go." This was to fulfill the word that he had spoken, "I did not lose a single one of those whom you gave me." Then Simon Peter, who had a sword, drew it and struck the high priest's slave and cut off his right ear. The slave's name was Malchus. And Jesus said to Peter, "Put your sword back into its sheath. Am I not to drink the cup that the Father has given me?" So the soldiers, their officer, and the Jewish police arrested Jesus and bound him. First, they took him to Annas, who was the father-in-law of Caiaphas, the high priest that year. Caiaphas was the one who had advised the Jews that it was better to have one person die for the people. Simon Peter and another disciple followed Jesus. Since that disciple was known to the high priest, he went with Jesus into the courtyard of the high priest. But Peter was standing outside the gate. So the other disciple, who was known to the high priest, went out, spoke to the woman who guarded the gate, and brought Peter in. The woman said to Peter, "You are not also one of the man's disciples, are you?" He said, "I am not." Now the slaves and the police had made a charcoal fire because it was cold, and they were standing round it and warming themselves. Peter was also standing with them and warming himself.
Then the high priest questioned Jesus about his disciples and about his teaching. And Jesus answered, "I have spoken openly to the world. I have always taught in synagogues and in the temple where all the Jews come together. I have said nothing in secret. Why do you ask me? Those who heard what I said to them, they know what I said. When he had said this, one of the police standing nearby struck Jesus on the face, saying, "Is that how you answer the high priest?" Jesus answered, "If I have spoken wrongly, testify to the wrong. But if I have spoken rightly, why do you strike me?" And then Anna sent him bound to Caiaphas, the high priest.
Now Simon Peter was standing and warming himself. They asked him, "You are not also one of his disciples, are you?" He denied it and said, "I am not." One of the slaves of the high priest, a relative of the man whose ear Peter had cut off, asked, "Did I not see you in the garden with him?" Again, Peter denied it. And at that moment, the cock crowed.
Then the soldiers took Jesus from Caiaphas to Pilate's headquarters. It was early in the morning. They themselves did not enter the headquarters so as to avoid ritual defilement and to be able to eat the Passover. So Pilate went out to them and said, "What accusation do you bring against this man?" They answered, "If this man were not a criminal, we would not have handed him over to you." Pilate said to them, "Take him yourselves and judge him according to your law." The Jews replied, "We are not permitted to put anyone to death." This was to fulfill what Jesus had said when he indicated the kind of death he was to die. Then Pilate entered the headquarters again, summoned Jesus, and asked him, "Are you the king of the Jews?" Jesus answered, "Do you ask this on your own, or did others tell you about me?" Pilate replied, "I am not a Jew, am I? Your own nation and the chief priests have handed you over to me. What have you done?" Jesus answered, "My kingdom is not from this world. If my kingdom were from this world, my followers would be fighting to keep me from being handed over to the Jews. But as it is, my kingdom is not from here." Pilate asked him, "So you are a king?" Jesus answered, "You say that I am king. For this I was born, and for this I came into the world, to testify to the truth. Everyone who belongs to the truth listens to my voice." Pilate asked him, "What is truth?"
After he had said this, Pilate went out to the Jews again and told them, "I find no case against him, but you have a custom that I release someone for you at Passover. Do you want me to release for you the king of the Jews?" They shouted in reply, "Not this man, but Barabbas." Now Barabbas was a bandit.
Then Pilate took Jesus and had him flogged, and the soldiers wove a crown of thorns and put it on his head, and they dressed him in a purple robe. They kept coming up to him, saying, "Hail, King of the Jews," and striking him on the face. Pilate went out again and said to them, "Look, I am bringing him out to you to let you know that I find no case against him." So Jesus came out, wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe, and Pilate said to them, "Here is the man." When the chief priests and the police saw him, they shouted, "Crucify him! Crucify him!" Pilate said to them, "Take him yourselves and crucify him. I find no case against him." The Jews answered him, "We have a law, and according to that law, he ought to die because he has claimed to be the Son of God." Now when Pilate heard this, he was more afraid than ever. He entered his headquarters again and asked Jesus, "Where are you from?" But Jesus gave him no answer. Pilate therefore said to him, "Do you refuse to speak to me? Do you not know that I have power to release you and power to crucify you?" Jesus answered him, "You would have no power over me unless it had been given to you from above. Therefore, the one who handed me over to you is guilty of a greater sin." From then on, Pilate tried to release him, but the Jews cried out, "If you release this man, you are no friend of the emperor. Everyone who claims to be a king sets himself against the emperor."
When Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus outside and sat on the judge's bench at a place called the stone pavement, or in Hebrew, Gabbatha. That was the day of preparation for the Passover, and it was about noon. He said to the Jews, "Here is your king." They cried out, "Away with him! Away with him! Crucify him!" Pilate asked them, "Shall I crucify your king?" The chief priests answered, "We have no king but the emperor." Then Pilate handed him over to them to be crucified.
So the soldiers took Jesus, and carrying the cross by himself, he went out to what is called the place of the skull, which in Hebrew is called Golgotha. And there they crucified him, and with him two others, one on either side, with Jesus between them. Pilate also had an inscription written and put on the cross. It read, "Jesus of Nazareth, the King of the Jews." Many of the Jews read this inscription because the place where Jesus was crucified was near the city, and it was written in Hebrew, in Latin, and in Greek. And then the chief priests of the Jews said to Pilate, "Do not write, 'The King of the Jews,' but 'This man said, I am King of the Jews.'" And Pilate answered, "What I have written, I have written." When the soldiers had crucified Jesus, they took his clothes and divided them into four parts, one for each soldier. They also took his tunic. Now the tunic was seamless, woven in one piece from the top. So they said to one another, "Let us not tear it, but cast lots for it to see who will get it." This was to fulfill what the scripture says, "They divided my clothes among themselves, and for my clothing they cast lots." And that is what the soldiers did.
Meanwhile, standing near the cross of Jesus were his mother and his mother's sister, Mary, the wife of Clopas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus saw his mother and the disciple whom he loved standing beside her, he said to his mother, "Woman, here is your son." And then he said to the disciple, "Here is your mother." And from that hour, the disciple took her into his own home. After this, when Jesus knew that all was now finished, he said, in order to fulfill the scripture, "I am thirsty." A jar full of sour wine was standing there, so they put a sponge full of the wine on a branch of hyssop and held it to his mouth. When Jesus had received the wine, he said, "It is finished." Then he bowed his head and gave up his spirit.
Since it was the day of preparation, the Jews did not want the bodies left on the cross during the Sabbath, especially because that Sabbath was a day of great solemnity. So they asked Pilate to have the legs of the crucified men broken and the bodies removed. Then the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and of the other who had been crucified with him. But when they came to Jesus and saw that he was already dead, they did not break his legs. Instead, one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear, and at once blood and water came out. He who saw this has testified so that you also may believe. His testimony is true, and he knows that he tells the truth. These things occurred so that the scripture might be fulfilled, "None of his bones shall be broken." And again, another passage of scripture says, "They will look on the one whom they have pierced."
After these things, Joseph of Arimathea, who was a disciple of Jesus, though a secret one because of his fear of the Jews, asked Pilate to let him take away the body of Jesus. Pilate gave him permission, so he came and removed his body. Nicodemus, who had at first come to Jesus by night, also came, bringing a mixture of myrrh and aloes, weighing about 100 pounds. They took the body of Jesus and wrapped it with the spices in linen cloths, according to the burial custom of the Jews. Now there was a garden in the place where he was crucified, and in the garden there was a new tomb in which no one had ever been laid. And so, because it was the Jewish day of preparation and the tomb was nearby, they laid Jesus there. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
seated.
Let us pray. Holy One, we are here. We don't want to turn away from you this night, but our hearts are heavy and our burdens are great. We lay them at the foot of your cross. On the cross, you bore the weight of all our cares, and that good news is heavy on our souls. So we offer prayers this day for people caught up in crowds, anxiety, fear, and the rush of judgment. May we be non-anxious witnesses to the pain of the world, able to respond in compassion. Draw us to the peace of your cross.
We see your body broken, O Lord, and we remember the brokenness in our community and our lives. Bring your healing, O God, into the broken places, the wounds, the fears, the injuries we don't know how to heal. We seek your wholeness, your shalom, for the people we know to be in need of healing. Draw us to the healing of your cross.
Your cross is a symbol for the whole church, for the ways we have divided ourselves and set up walls where you seek bridges. Forgive us. When the body of Christ is broken, you are the one who bleeds. Lead us to understanding, to acceptance of differences, and to love of our siblings who serve you differently. Bless your church in this place and around the world, that we may represent your love to the world. Bless our siblings and other faith traditions as well, that in our embrace, the world may see a path toward peace. Draw us to the unity of your cross.
Your cross embraces all of creation. And we are mindful that we have focused too narrowly on our own salvation, as if we could personally be saved while the world burned. Lead us into a deeper care for this planet we call home. Lead us to seek and savor the majestic beauty around us, from sunset over jagged mountain peaks to dew on a spider web in the early dawn. Lead us to care for people impacted by a changing climate, for people impacted by our disregard for our effect on the planet. Be with people in the path of winds, rains, fires, and floods. As you stretch out your arms on the cross, reach into lives in need of your rescue. Draw us to the rescue of your cross.
We hear your voice crying out in pain on the cross, and we remember the voices crying out around us today. May we pour out our compassion instead of drowning them with our indifference. May we recognize and acknowledge the pain of their lives. Draw us to the cries of your cross. Hear our voices now as we bring all of our prayers, pain, and hope before you, praying together. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours now and forever. Amen.
Were you there when they crucified my Lord? Were you there when they crucified my Lord? Oh, to tremble.